Hello, welcome to the Monday, February 1st, 2021 edition of the Sands Internet Storm Center's Stormcast. My name is Johannes Ulrich, and I'm recording from Jacksonville, Florida. Let's start out today with a quick lesson on domain registrar security. We have two different events here that sort of fit that pattern in different ways. First of all, Perl.com, the domain. Apparently, the registrar account for the people behind Perl.com was compromised, and as a result, Perl.com was redirected to a parking page and then ultimately offered for sale. This is still ongoing. Last I checked, it just returned an empty page, so maybe the good folks behind Perl are getting control back slowly, but this can be a lengthy and very disruptive process. Only good part here, the actual domain that is used for a lot of the Perl tools and such is perl.org, not .com. So Perl downloads and such should not really be affected by this, but shows somewhat that probably they didn't do as well as they should in maintaining their credentials. The second domain is spamcop.net. That domain is now operated by Cisco. And of course, a lot of spam filters are relying on updates from spamcop.net. Problem here was not a hijack of the domain, but instead Cisco just forgot to renew the domain. So it expired and then was briefly not reachable over the weekend until someone at Cisco got their credit card out and re-registered the domain. Typically, when you forget to renew a domain, there is sort of a grace period, so it's not necessarily easy for an attacker to quickly take over the domain, but nevertheless, of course, a name resolution for your domain tends to cease. I think a good lesson here is to build some rigor, some procedures around your domain registrations. Make sure you're alerted of any expiring domains or set up some form of auto renewal for them. And then, of course, please, please set up two-factor authentication. As far as users is concerned, HTTPS provides a very limited protection here because once an attacker has access to the domain, they can quickly obtain certificates for that domain. And about a week ago, a new version of libgcrypt was released, libgcrypt 1.9, and a couple days after it was released, a notice came out, please don't use this library, it does include a critical vulnerability. Luckily, up to that point, because it was of a major update, only very few Linux distributions and such had upgraded to it. I believe it was really only Gentoo and Fedora that sort of started using libgcrypt 1.9. And over the weekend now, we got libgcrypt 1.9.1, which does fix the vulnerability. It's a buffer overflow that apparently is easy to exploit. Researchers at the Chinese Academy of Sciences in Beijing have worked on a pretty interesting paper to try and fingerprint quick traffic. Quick, of course, is supposed to be HTTP/3 in the near future. And what they looked at was whether or not it's possible to detect a particular website that a user is visiting via HTTP/3 or quick. In short, Quick is really HTTP/2 over UDP, and it only is possible via TLS. So you have to look at encrypted traffic, and with that, more at traffic analysis versus outright looking at packet content. And what these researchers did was look at packet sizes, look at the speed at which packets arrived, and they were surprised to find that it's actually easier to fingerprint a particular website a user is visiting via Quick than it was via HTTPS. Now, of course, at this point, Quick not being yet quite a standard is not as widely used as, for example, HTTPS. So the data set that they had may be a little bit more limited, but still interesting that really just looking at artifacts like packet size and arrival times and the like, it is possible to identify various websites.